to see is an account of the tragedy which befell a group of 5 youths. It is all the more tragic in that they were young. But had they lived very, very long lives, they could not have expected, nor would they have wished to see, as much of the mad and macabre as they were to see that day. For them, an idyllic summer afternoon became a nightmare. For 30 years, the files collected dust in the Cold Cases Division of the Travis County Police Department. Over 1,300 pieces of evidence were collected from the crime scene at the Hewitt residence. Yet none of the evidence was more compelling than the classified police footage of the crime scene walkthrough.
Test, test, test. Okay, this is August 20th, 1973. The time is 3:47 p.m. Location is the Hewitt residence on Route 17. It's where victim one was found. We're gonna do a walkthrough, and we're now descending the stairs into the furnace room. There's over here, there's scratch marks along the wall. There's some more over here, along here, and oh, there's something over here. Seems, looks like a clot of hair and a embedded fingernail. All right, we're gonna go move into the actual furnace room.
The events of that day were to lead to one of the most bizarre crimes in the annals of American history.
Good morning, victims, and today I'm going to be doing a speed build of the Hewitt House, also known the house in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, premiered in 2003. Yes, this is the remake of the first Chainsaw Massacre, but when I grew up, this is the one I seen, so I did the Hewitt House. Took me quite a long time. Actually, it took me almost 5 hours to do this build, and I will admit, near the end of this build, I got so tired that I kind of was just throwing stuff in, and I wasn't realizing a few things, but I put it all together as best as I can, and I hope you guys enjoy it, and it spooks you out a little bit. I will also be telling you guys a scary story during this speed build. This scary story was originated from Creepypasta. If you don't know what Creepypasta is, you can just type that in. I'll leave a link in the description. And it is just a website of stories written by a mass majority of different people. So this story is written The Swamp, and it's not very long. It's quite a short story. I have not read the story myself yet, so it will be the first time for both of us. Okay. The Swamp. It has been exactly a year now since the incident happened, the day that my younger brother John was killed. I have tried and tried to forget about what happened, but it's still burned in my mind. So, no, this is rather a cliche, but I am recording this and putting it online in hopes that sharing what happened for all to hear will bring some solace. My brother and I had a very strong bond, beyond what most siblings have because of our isolation from civilization in southern Louisiana. We were raised by our mother, who not only assumed the additional position of a father, but as our teacher due to the distance from the nearest school. We were forced to be homeschooled. Our father disappeared when we were very young. He left one day and never returned. Our mom says he left her for a younger woman, but I'm pretty sure now that isn't true. Last year today, on my brother's 17th birthday, we decided to take the canoe out through the swamp in hopes of finding an alligator that we could shoot. John and I always love hunting alligators, and it was so fulfilling to bag a big gator and get to feed the family. Well, I have wandered off topic. So we were out on the canoe rowing around the cold, salty sea air met the hot, humid swamp air, creating a very interesting atmosphere. We had already in past adventures scouted a 3-mile radius around the house, but we were determined to reach farther than ever. Rowing in a canoe isn't the fastest means of transportation, but it works. We had gotten very good at swerving around the protruding stumps, trees, and the occasional rock that poked out in the murky green water. The sudden rush of water knocked us out of a trance. It was an alligator. The time we had been waiting for was right there. My brother rowed closer as I grabbed my .45 revolver. The alligator wasn't affected by us. It continued to swim north. The sun was settling as my brother gazed out towards the sea. His voice trailed off. I looked to see what he was looking at and almost couldn't believe what I saw. Standing on a small island were two people who appeared to be blankly staring at us, mouth agape. And in between them was a glowing object that neither of us could make out what it was. "Hey," I yelled to the two men. Strangely, there was no response. They didn't even move, blink, shift, or anything. "Let's get out of here," I said to John, but he didn't reply. The canoe was drifting, and the only change by the people on the island was that their heads gradually turning to keep their blank stares on us. "Hey, let's go," I spoke up. He stared blankly at the small island. "John," I yelled out again. No response. I was about to start paddling, but John unexpectedly leaped out of the canoe and into the murky water. "What are you doing?" I asked him as he swam, then walked to the island. Before he was out of the water, however, I noticed something. It appeared to be black hair emerging from the sea, which followed by the top of a head. Then what I was expecting to be a person, but that's where I went wrong. Walking out of the ocean was something I had never seen before. It was tall, probably 7 or 8 feet. It had long black hair. Its black eyes looked foggy due to what was most likely a film over them. They slanted down its face at an angle. Its face was narrow and sharp-like. It had been starved. This absolutely terrified me. I mean, what are you supposed to do when you see something like that? Anyways, the creature walked up to the island and the two people shot one last look looking at me. This one was different, though. I saw tears and absolute fear suppressed by their blank stares. It was like their human instinct were trying to prevail over what trance they were in, but there was to no avail. The creature grabbed both the men, one in each arm, turned around and returned to the ocean. I saw bubbles emerging from a little bit when their heads became submerged. Now I'm sure you don't believe me, but I saw what I saw. If someone had told me this story, I wouldn't have believed them either. I yelled at John, "We need to get out of here now," and his response is still unforgettable. His head slowly turned around as he gave me a blank stare, then turned back and approached the glowing object with a flash of red color, then returned to its white shine. "John," I cried out, he just stared at me. I fled. I went home and told my mom all about it, but she didn't believe me. She kept telling me to tell her the truth about what happened, but it was, and still is, the truth. You have to believe me. After insisting it was the truth, she finally gave in and left to go find the elusive glowing item on the island. She never returned. I have been living by myself for the past year. I just wanted to get this story out. I'm starting to worry, however. I think the light is getting closer because at night, if I look just at the right angle, through the trees, I can see what appears to be a faint light. I am tired of living in fear. I'm going to submit this now. Go check out the light, then I'll update this when I know the truth. Goodbye for now. And that is the end of the story. I hope you guys liked it. I liked it a lot. It was pretty intense. Did any of you guys believe it? It could be true. Do you believe her? I guess we'll never know. Leave your thoughts in the comments below. What you guys think. Alright, and here's the rest of the Speedville for you guys to enjoy. And if I don't see you later on, good afternoon, good evening, and good night. Thank you.
the actual furnace room. Watch yourself. Look out. Oh, man. Oh. Look out. You got it? All right. This is the actual furnace room going into where they expected to perpetrate it. Got a bit of a jump there. Got it?
That's okay. Don't worry.
Come on back here. Follow me.
Come on. Ah! 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 Ah!
The crime scene was not properly secured by Travis County Police. Two investigating officers were fatally wounded that day. This is the only known image of Thomas Hewitt, the man they called Leatherface. The case today still remains open.